Today's episode is brought to you by TapCalf Transmissions, the brand new Star Wars Expanded Universe podcast brought to you by myself and Corey Loses. TapCalf Transmissions is essentially a Star Wars Expanded Universe book club. We're covering Legends novels in order, starting with the post-Endor era. Episode 1, which is available now, was on the truce at Bakura, and the next episode, which will be live streamed and then available on the 13th of June, is on X-Wing Rogue Squadron. The episodes are available not only on YouTube, but we're rolling out across various podcasting platforms. So far, we're on Spotify and Podbean, links to everything down in the description. Anyway, run the intro. Hey guys, this is Eckhart Slaughter. Hello and welcome to another Star Wars Legends lore video. Today, we'll be covering a time period which I think is underrepresented on YouTube, but I find incredibly interesting, and that's the pre-Clone Wars Republic era. To be frank, part of the reason this time period is so fun to look at is because of the excellent novel Plagueis, which, in my opinion, is one of the top three EU books of all time. Now, Plagueis is so good largely because it takes puzzle pieces which had been set up throughout Star Wars history and puts them together in a really interesting way. The book makes connections that serve to make the individual pieces of lore all that better. And one good example of this is Trade Federation battleships, or at first, Trade Federation freighters. So, if you're familiar with Legends, you probably know that the 1,000 or so years before the Clone Wars were a relatively stable and peaceful era, and this was achieved, at least in part, because of the Rusan Reformations. The Rusan Reformations placed limits on the Republic military, decentralizing the government's main defensive forces, and instead moving the onus to individual systems and planets. However, other regulations also limited the size of warships, with any of the big ships that existed during the era, like the Kuwadi Mandator, being heavily limited in terms of firepower and also hyperdrive speed. So that means before the Clone Wars, the Republic itself wasn't heavily militarized, and limitations were placed on the military of star systems. Now, while it is true that sometimes the Rusan Reformations were skirted or even ignored, they generally prevented the creation of any large invasion armadas. That takes us to the Trade Federation, which, in the decades prior to their invasion of Naboo, had consolidated enough power within the galaxy to actually have a seat on the Senate. They were the perfect faction to create the backbone of a military which would existentially threaten the Republic. Let me explain. Although it was impossible to create large capital ships without facing Republic scrutiny, the Trade Federation engaged heavily in, well, trade. So it was not surprising when they created a fleet of several thousand Lucra Hulk class freighters. The Lucra Hulk was interesting. It was, at its creation, not armed, but also a massive platform where weapons could be added. It had an incredible amount of cargo space and a relatively fast Class 2 hyperdrive. The Trade Federation was likely the dominant non-Republic economic superpower in the entire galaxy. It had abused the Republic's formation of tax-free trade zones and had aggressively expanded over about a century to secure an enormous amount of political power. However, those who ran the Trade Federation didn't want to be simply a superpower, they wanted to be the superpower, even surpassing the Republic. This ideal would be later manipulated by Palpatine. However, with the Stark Hyperspace War, which saw Trade Federation vessels attacked by raiders, their ambitions became even more aggressive, and a plan was created to overthrow the Republic. Part of this was the formation of a secret droid army, but another part was the creation of a powerful navy, which is the topic of today's video. So, with a fleet of Lucra Hulk freighters created, the Trade Federation used the Yunshori Uprising of 33 BBY as the first step to militarization. They did this by preying on angst surrounding the Rusan Reformation, specifically the fact that without a centralized defense force, the New Republic practically could not respond as quickly to certain threats. Here's a quote from Plagueis. Should the Trade Federation be expected to absorb the losses it has sustained because of pirate attacks, the Republic refuses to create a military to police those sectors while at the same time prohibiting us from protecting our cargoes with defensive weapons or droid soldiers. Later, Palpatine reveals that the Republic will grant the Trade Federation the ability to arm their ship with both turbo lasers and droid starfighters. So by this point, the Trade Federation has essentially skirted the Rusan Reformation by creating a fast, hyperspace-capable ship with strong armor and shielding, which is now carrying fighters and given turbo lasers. The capability of these ships, as well as their secret droid army, was obviously seen during the invasion of Naboo, but this was only step one. Although later the Trade Federation was ordered to disband their freighters, they simply removed the cores and heavily militarized both the central portion and the ring of the Lucre Hulk battleships while seeming to comply with orders. By the time the actual Clone Wars itself was initiated, although these refits had only begun, the CIS still had a huge fleet of gigantic capital ships. With the war now fully underway and the legalities of the Rusan Reformation now thrown out the window, the Trade Federation could then just upgrade their ships in plain sight. But the key is, they had all of their pieces ready to build upon when the time was right. The Republic, on the other hand, had to scramble, trying to bring old Mandator-class dreadnoughts up to date, while thankfully also relying on a secretly constructed fleet of Venators and other capital ships. The Lucre Hulk is genius because it allowed the CIS to militarize against a faction which had been in power for thousands of years, and they did so under its very nose. The Lucre Hulk remained one of the most powerful Clone Wars era capital ships throughout the entire conflict, and to be honest, it gave the CIS a nice advantage. They were perfect for blockading planets, leading fleets, or basically doing whatever else. Also worth noting is that the Lucre Hulk was basically perfect for their military doctrine. The Trade Federation and the CIS generally obviously relied on battle droids and mass-produced droid fighters. Guess what? The Lucre Hulk has a crap load of cargo space, so that's another way that you can quickly bring your vessels up to military spec. Anyway, I just really appreciate the way that Plagueis suggests, if not outright points out, this evolution of Trade Federation capital ships, but maybe I'm also just a conspiracy theorist yelling about things that may not be true. Let me know what you think down in the comments. Today's hashtag AskEk question from Whiskey Docent is an interesting one. How did Luke know where specifically to land on Dagobah in order to meet Yoda, as Obi-Wan didn't give Luke the exact coordinates of where Yoda was? And I actually plan to do a video on this whole topic, but I don't think it needs all of that, and I'll just dispense with it here. So, in Heir to the Empire, we get the following quote. There was an affirmative twitter from the rear, the translation appearing across his computer scope. Good, Luke said, and turned his attention back to the cloud-shrouded planet rushing up to meet them. It was odd, he thought, how it had only been on that first trip into Dagobah that the sensors had so totally failed on approach. Or perhaps not so odd, perhaps that had been Yoda, deliberately suppressing his instruments so as to be able to guide him unsuspectingly to the proper landing site. So, unsurprisingly, the explanation is, well, the Force. Even without Yoda, I think Luke's intuition and use of the Force probably would have brought him to the right place, but I quite like the explanation from Heir to the Empire, so that's that. Anyway, thank you guys for watching. If you have a question of your own that you'd like me to answer at the end of a future video, leave it down in the comments with the hashtag AskEk. It just makes it easier for me to find. Anyway, until next time, this has been your pal, Eckhart Slatter. Just a reminder that I am in LA right now for EA Play, and I will be having a meetup with other Star Wars YouTubers, including Star Wars Explained, Battlefront Updates, Hello Greedo, and others. I hope to see some of you there. It was super fun last year. I met a few of you that I still talk to regularly. It's at the Scum and Villainy Cantina. If you're in LA or the surrounding area and you'd like more information, that's all in the description. Anyway, until next time, guys, this has been Eckhart Slatter. May the Force be with you.